I look in the mirror. I'm in a sleeveless black dress and low-heeled court shoes. I'm wearing a string of pearls that once had belonged to Russell's mother. My bobbed hair has done its little curl at the end and is slightly flipped away from the nape of my neck. It's only now I realise what I've done. I'm going to my husband's funeral, dressed as Jackie Kennedy. I'm Sophie Townsend, with Goodbye to All This, an original podcast from the BBC World Service. Chapter 6, Funeral. I'm far less beautiful and far less stylish than Jackie Kennedy. The dress isn't Chanel, the pearls are fake. But here I am. All I need is a little pillbox hat to complete the look. I go to our room, my room. It's a mess, with the mattress on the floor the girls have been taking turns sleeping on while the other sleeps in the bed with me, since the undertakers took their father away. The bed's not made and the girls have their pyjamas and clothes strewn all over the floor. There's a pile of Russell's suits on the chair I'd started taking out of the cupboard to send to the charity shop until someone told me that maybe I should wait. I'd been ruthless in taking the suits off their hangers, folding them up, and now I don't have the energy to put them back where they belong. I'm not sure where they belong. I look in the wardrobe for an alternative to the Jackie dress-ups, and there's nothing. Just his white cotton shirt, which I've been wearing most of the week, but there's a spot of something on the front. I've spilt some cake, I think, one of the endless cakes brought by friends and family that I never have the appetite for, but that I absent-mindedly nibble on anyway as I go through the paperwork late at night when I can't sleep. And there's no time to change anyway because the taxi's here and I yell to the girls to come downstairs with me. I take off the pearls and leave them at the table by the front door. The taxi's double parked, meaning no one can get past in our narrow street, and I have to rush the girls out the door. But we get to the gate and Poppy decides she'd like to bring her purse and wants to go back inside to fetch it. I hold up my hand to the driver. One sec. He looks at me impatiently. There's a woman behind him beeping her horn. Poppy comes out with the purse. And we're just about to get in the cab when I see the dog walker, with the dog herself trotting alongside him. He calls out to me, quickens his pace, pulls the dog along at a speed she's finding hard in the heat. Katie's been staying at the dog walker's place since Russell died. With all the people visiting and the endless flower deliveries, each knock at the door made her bark and growl in a way that frayed our nerves and eventually had me ask him if he could keep her with him. For now. One sec, I say to the cab driver. One sec, I say to the woman beeping her horn, who rolls her eyes and puts her car in reverse, forcing the car behind her to reverse too, as the taxi drives forward, the driver indicating by looping his finger round and round that he'll drive round the block and come back. I hope that's what the signal means. The girls are bickering now. The dog walker, who loves the dog and loves us and loves all animals and all people and all trees as well, and proclaims his love loudly and often as he walks the neighbourhood, tells me he wants to come to the funeral with the dog, but he's not sure how to get there, and could we take him? And I explain to him that the dog can't come And I think how unlike Jackie Kennedy's life my own is at this moment in time. At any moment, really, but the distinction is pretty pointed now. The taxi's back, but he's not going to wait forever. A neighbour comes to the rescue, offers to sort the dog and the dog walker out. The same neighbour who gave Russell the use of her rocking chair to keep on our porch so he could sit outside when he wanted to. All those days he was sick. Jesus loves you, says the dog walker, and the dog whines in agreement. We get in the cab and drive. The girls are still bickering. I've tried to time it so that we're the last ones to arrive, so everyone will be sitting and ready, and we'll just slip into our seats at the front, and we won't have to talk to anyone, and it will just begin. But I've timed it wrong because I'm always early. Russell and I used to argue about it. I thought it took an hour to get anywhere and he thought it took 15 minutes. One of us was always wrong. He couldn't stand my terror of being late. I couldn't stand the fact that he could never make it anywhere on time. So now, this morning, the girls and I walk in with the throng of people all taking their seats, and everyone who sees us comes and hugs us, and it's hard because I just want to get the girls settled and I don't know what to say to anyone, and Bear is resentful of the crowd. And I'm embarrassed, of course, of this resentment she wears. And I feel that somehow she should at least pretend to be more grateful and gracious. I feel a flash of anger towards her. I wish I didn't. It feels very wrong to be so angry at my child on the day we're remembering her father. We walk down to our seats. Eventually, everyone is here and ready, and it begins. I look at the order of service written by me, and I read it through as if it isn't, as if it's a thing I have had very little to do with. And I look at the photos of him as if they were selected by someone else, because it's the only way I can get through it. On long car trips, I used to play this game called If You Could Have Anyone Play at Your Memorial Service, Who Would It Be? I'd come up with a list of music I'd loved throughout my life. Olivia Newton-John, Madonna, followed by Susie and the Banshees. Sometimes I'd add Dolly Parton just for fun. But he never really got into it, thought it was morbid and could never see the point of hypotheticals. There was one drive he got into a real mood about it and I wouldn't let it go. We had such a fight about it. We didn't talk for the rest of the drive. 4 hours to get up the coast. Funny things you remember, sitting at your husband's funeral, as Jimi Hendrix singing All Along the Watchtower blares over the PA. He never said it would be Jimmy. But it would have been Jimmy. I smile a little. His three best friends all speak about youthful exploits, languid conversation, passionate debate. His cousin speaks of his boyhood, of family. My mother says a few words. Poppy's getting bored, looks around and sees a friend of hers, starts waving, asking me if they can go out and play. And I feel that flash of anger again as I shush her. Those flashes of anger, they'll pop up again and again over the years. And I know parents get angry with their children, but I also know that some of my anger isn't about them, but about him. And they'll learn to deal with that in a way they shouldn't have to. I wish again and again that I wasn't angry on the day we remembered their father. But I too am getting restless, and I wish I'd kept the pearls on just for something to do with my hands. It's the first time I've had nothing to do except sit since he died, and I feel like I've forgotten something, that there are things that need attending to. It's sitting here now in this hall that I realise the twitch in my eye, the involuntary, almost imperceptible muscle movement that kept at me and at me all the time he was sick. That night he died, the last week of organising. It's just now, this morning, gone. Unlike Jackie at JFK's funeral, I speak. I lay claim to Russell and to our life together. I tell our friends and family how much I loved him, how much he loved me and our children. I get up and I tell my friends and family that sometimes it seemed as if we agreed on nothing. That sometimes we fought over the colour of paint on the walls and the size of the couch. And sometimes I irritated him and he irritated me, but that we loved each other. I tell them about sitting with him in the movies, sometimes just watching him watch the screen, thinking about how handsome he was and how lucky I felt. I tell them that I loved the way he could make me laugh with the raising of an eyebrow, about the way we spoke in a shorthand that relied on shared stories we couldn't even really remember anymore. I tell them that he loved his children above all else, that he'd been changed by the girls. And I could see Poppy and Bear looking at me as I said it. And I thought, this is true about how much he loved you, and you need to take this in front of all those people, that you were loved by him more than he loved anything else. And I return to my seat, and in a little while, it's all finished, and everyone gets out of their seats and fills their cups with tea and coffee and their plates with little cakes and quiches, and they talk about him and they hug the girls who don't want to be hugged, and the dog walker embraces me and he tells me that the dog would have really liked this, and I agree, but that she would have barked all through it. We don't know it now, but the dog never comes back to live with us, because we simply can't manage it, and she and the dog walker form an unwavering partnership. And sometimes I pay her vet bills and the fines he gets from the council when he forgets to keep her on leash at the park. People peel away and the girls and I go home, and we go straight up to our room. My room. Our room. We hurry up the stairs so we don't have to look at the dining room where his bed still sits. The bed he slept in when he could no longer make it up the stairs. the bed he died in. We don't think back to the morning after his death, when we took turns to lie with him, when Poppy put frangipanis in his hair, when Bear held his hand and stroked his head for the longest time. And we don't think of that moment when we walked out of the house, the three of us, and left my parents in charge of meeting with the undertaker, who put Russell's body in a plastic bag and wheeled him to their waiting black car. We don't think of any of that, because right now, we can't. Instead, we go upstairs, we lie together in my bed, our bed, my bed, the ceiling fan on high. I wonder how we got all this done in the week since he died. But how we organised the tea and coffee and all those little cakes and quiches and the PA and the order of service. And that furious rush to get things done is over now. And I'm not sure what happens next. Except that whatever does, we'll do it without him. Goodbye to All This is produced by me, Sophie Townsend, and Eleanor McDowell. The music has been specially created for the podcast by Jeremy Walmsley. Alan Hall is the executive producer. The consultant story editor from CBC Podcasts is Chris Oak. The BBC World Service podcast editor is John Minnell. It's a Falling Tree production for the BBC World Service.